Mesdames et messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, bonsoir. Bonsoir à tout le monde et merci d'être venu encore une fois à notre série de débats, les grands débats canadiens. I see some looks of panic on the faces of our debaters. Don't worry, it's not going to happen in French tonight. Welcome to this first debate in our 2016-17 series of debates on key issues in Canadian history and politics, the Great Canadian Debates. As you know, the Honourable Peter Millican, who holds the record for occupying the Speaker's chair in the House of Commons longer than anyone else in the history of Canada, will, as always, bring his superb moderating skills to bear to keep our two fine debaters on topic and on time. And who are our debaters? Esteemed Globe and Mail columnist Margaret Wente, with whom I had the pleasure of working when I was on the editorial board of the Globe, and Susan Eng, a well-known defender of the interests of Canada's seniors. And these two debaters will be on opposite sides of the resolution, Canada should stop coddling its spoiled seniors. And based on some of the comments I saw on our Facebook page, I think some of the people in the audience may have been here to argue a resolution in favor of bringing back capital punishment for anybody who thinks that we should think about the position of seniors in Canadian society. I'm proud, as always, that the Macdonald-Laurier Institute has brought all of the elements of great debate together this evening, and that thanks to our videographer way up there in the back, McZosky, we're able to give even those who cannot be here this evening a chance to participate in another debate about an idea or an issue of crucial importance to Canadians. Ideas matter. You have to think that if you're in the think tank business. And we've heard over and over from Canadians that they're looking to hear important ideas debated intelligently and thoroughly in an atmosphere of respect and goodwill. As I always like to say, in other words, they don't want question period. We strive to make every one of our debates meet this high standard, and I know that this evening will be no exception. Our special thanks to this evening to those organizations that have helped us to make this event come to pass. That's the Canadian War Museum, the Hecht Foundation for sponsoring these debates, and our many friends and other sponsors. And now I'd like to turn things over to Peter for this evening's debate. Peter.
Thank you. Thank you, Brian, for your kind comments and your organization of the debates that we have and that are so much appreciated. I'm supposed to begin by indicating for you the format of the debate. But before I do, I'll introduce our two debaters. Margaret Wente is the one who will be arguing in favor of the motion. She's an award-winning Globe and Mail columnist. She is known for her controversial commentaries on diverse subject matter in print, on television, and on the radio. And she's also edited two leading business magazines, Canadian Business and ROB, I think it's Report on Business Magazine. People in business, I guess, like Rob instead, but anyway. And she's authored two novels, Accidental Canadian, Reflections on My Home and Not Native Land, and You Can't Say That in Canada. Our second debater, who will be arguing on the other side, negative side, if you want to call it that, on the motion, is Susan Eng, a lawyer and former executive vice president of the Canadian Association of Retired Persons. During her eight-year tenure as head of advocacy, Susan led the Canadian Association of Retired Persons to shape the public discourse and secure legislative change on key issues such as pension reform, investor protection, mandatory retirement, workplace age discrimination, home care, and seniors' poverty. So I think we have two excellent debaters for the resolution that we're having discussed this evening. There will be a 20-minute speech maximum from each of our two debaters. Then each will have a 5-minute rebuttal. We will then have 25 minutes for questions from the audience, and response, of course, that counts as part of the 25 minutes. And then there will be concluding statements by each of the debaters, 5 minutes each. That will conclude the debate, but before we begin, I would like to ask for your views on the resolution. The resolution is resolved: Canada must stop coddling its spoiled seniors. Those who agree could perhaps raise their hands. Those who disagree, perhaps, could raise them. Huh. And are there any who have are unsure or are okay?
Undecided.
Well, I think it's obvious which has the majority at the moment, but we'll see what happens after the debate. So, to begin the debate, I'm going to call on Margaret Wente to lead off with her opening address. Margaret, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And thanks to the Macdonald-Laurier Institute for sponsoring these debates, especially this one, because this is one of the most important debates and discussions that we can have, and like it or not, we will be having it for a long time to come. It should be a nonpartisan debate, and it should be a real airing of ideas and of facts and truths, but as so often with these matters, it usually isn't, because we get all caught up in the day-to-day and the politics and the yelling and screaming and the rhetoric of it all. So I'm going to try to take a longer-term view this evening. And I can tell I have my work cut out for me. So just looking around the room, I would guess that there are two or three seniors maybe in the room. And so, could I have a show of hands? Seniors? I'm one of you. All right, well, I'd like to say something right off the bat. This resolution is a bit inflammatory. It is a bit inflammatory. And I personally do not believe that any one of you seniors has been coddled or spoiled. I don't believe that you are greedy geezers out to exploit every dollar from the system. I really don't. You worked hard. You played by the rules. You paid your dues. You paid into the system. And now, you know, you're getting back out what you earned. And what I say is, yes, that is all true. But, and the but is that as a group, we are a pretty privileged bunch. And so I think it's time for a little bit of a reality check about that. There is a myth that Canada is full of little old ladies eating cat food, and it's just not true. I think the reason it's not true is that we have a great system. We've built a great system. And it served us very well. But now, the greatest enemy of that system is complacency. We have to start rebalancing the equation between the young and the old. And if we don't manage to do that, the next generation is going to start wishing they could cast us out onto the ice floes before there's nothing left for them. So, Susan, who is the most formidable debate partner I could possibly imagine. I'm terrified of being on the stage with her because she knows more about this subject than anyone on earth, is going to make the case for seniors. I'm going to make the case for millennials. So what I'd like you to do, seniors, is listen with one ear as if you were yourself a millennial, if you can think back that far, and just try to maintain that perspective as you hear me out. So tonight I want to persuade you of four things. First, seniors as a whole are no longer a vulnerable group in need of all the special protections that we all get now. In fact, we are the most privileged generation in history. Second, our pension system, was designed for another age. It's time to rethink it. It's time to rethink the length and pattern of our working lives so that they're more in tune with the 21st century instead of the 19th. Third, the consequences of doing nothing would be catastrophic. Last, it's the good thing. I believe it is well within our ability to modify the current system so that it is fair, sustainable, and balanced, and takes care of the elderly without robbing the young. And I also believe that Susan and I, in the course of this evening, are going to find a lot that we actually agree on. So, life as a senior, let me ask you another question. When you were 30 years old, you bought your first house, you're up to your ears in debt, you had no money, you're working hard to establish your career. Did you ever imagine that when you got to be this age, life would be like this? Just think. Now, I know I didn't. I mean, when I thought of 65, it was sort of a fog descended. And I couldn't even imagine myself at 65. I thought I would be, you know, a little old lady with a cane and you know, bandages around her ankles, swollen ankles. And I never imagined much beyond that. But I thought I would be superannuated somewhere. I never imagined the life I have now, where I'm working still. I have a great life, really great life. I never thought that it would be like this at all. And yes, I know, it's easy to say, well, I'm one of the 1%, or one of the 5%, or one of the 20%, or 25%. But in fact, there are a lot of people like me, more and more. And personally, I don't relate to that senior label at all. You know, when the guy from Shoppers Drug Mart calls me up on Wednesdays, it's very irritating. He says, tomorrow's Senior's Thursday, dear. Come and get your bonus points. And you know, I feel like whacking him with my yoga mat. So the point is, 65 is just a number. And it's a totally meaningless number in terms of the way we live our lives. I'm going to get some water. Excuse me. The modern pension system was invented in the late 1800s by Otto von Bismarck, the German chancellor who also invented the modern welfare system. Pensions were a radical idea at the time. Until then, of course, people worked until they died. And the first pensions were provided for people who reached the age of 70, which very few of them did. And when Social Security was introduced in the United States in 1935, the retirement age was set at 65, which is very convenient for actuarial purposes because most men died by 58. So if we use the same formula today, in fact, you wouldn't be able to get a pension until you were 92. Retirement as a distinct phase of life didn't really get going until after World War II, when people started to live longer and longer and longer and longer. How long? Today, if you're a man of 60, you will live until about 87. If you're a woman of 60, you can expect to hang on until around 90. A lot of people today, more and more people, are spending more time in retirement than they spent working. This is already the case for many teachers who retired at 55. It's hard to argue that 65 is old. Millions of seniors today are what you might call young old. We are the beneficiaries of modern medicine. We've got these stents, pacemakers, hips, knees, what have you. And unlike all ages past, most of us are not broken down from hard physical work. According to the experts at the Canadian Institutes of Health Information, people who are between 65 and 74 today are generally quite similar in health to people who are 45 to 64. You know, 40 years ago, I would have been in a wheelchair because of my hips. Today, I have chromium hips, very flashy. And so I go to the Y and I cavort around with all the other old geezers who have artificial hips and knees, and, you know, we're in remarkably good shape. The main difference today between people in their 40s and people in their 60s is not function and it's not health. It's that this people in their 60s have a better life. We've got more time for yoga, travel, grandchildren, volunteer work, working out, making out, whatever. And those poor people in their 40s, you know, they're stuck with mortgages to pay and kids to put through university and no time. We're richer, they're poorer. I'm generalizing, but it is true that Canadian seniors are the wealthiest generation in history. Social policy has a lot to do with that. And now I'm going to quote an economics professor at Dalhousie University called Lars Oseberg, who said, "The reduction in the elderly poverty rate over the past three decades is the major success story of Canadian social policy in the 20th century." As recently as the 1970s, nearly 40% of Canadian seniors lived in poverty. Today, depending on how you measure, and there are 25 different ways to measure, it's somewhere around 6%, 7%. We'll argue about that later, but. Fred Vitez is a financial expert in Toronto, estimates that fewer than 10% of our seniors fit the traditional description of pensioners living on fixed incomes. Fewer than 10%. So I don't have to remind you also that we got lucky. We worked hard, yes, we paid our dues, yes, but we were also born at a golden moment in history. The economy was growing fast when we entered the workforce. University was practically free. We got jobs right away. Most of us had job security. We even had defined benefit pension plans. Ask your grandchildren what those are. You know, I bought my first house in Toronto in 1980 for $95,000. And you know what? You know what I did? I wasn't rich. I was a magazine editor. Hard to imagine. Back then, it took 5 years, an average of 5 years, to save up for a down payment for a house in Toronto. Today, it's 15 years. And that house that I bought for $95,000 would cost well over $1 million. And no magazine editor could afford it. And there aren't any magazine editors left anyway because they've all been laid off. Seniors have also done well compared to other income groups. Since 1999, the median net worth for seniors has nearly doubled. For millennials, it has been flat. According to the Bank of Montreal, the average Canadian man, age 65 plus, earns $45,817 a year, which is just slightly more than men aged 25 to 34. Statistics Canada says that seniors make almost as much as people in their prime earning years. How do we do internationally? The Conference Board of Canada gives Canada an A for its treatment of seniors. It says only two countries in the world, the Netherlands and France, treat seniors better than we do. Now, the seniors lobby is not likely to tell you these things because they're trying to perpetuate the myth that the retirement system is dangerously underfunded and that millions of people will face a precarious existence in retirement. But the evidence just doesn't support that. CD Howe Institute's Bob Baldwin, an impartial observer, looked at five different retirement reports. And here's what he concluded last month. The risk of a declining standard of living is largely a middle and upper income earner phenomenon, concentrated among the youngest age group and those not participating in a workplace pension plan. In other words, it's a limited problem, and it's mostly confined to the better off. Now, of course, not everyone is well off. Some seniors are poor and sick. They get terrible long-term care. Some people can't afford to keep their homes because they can't afford their property taxes. Our healthcare system is pretty bad at providing seniors care overall, and all these problems are real, and they need to be addressed. But what we've done with seniors policy has been, instead of targeting our efforts to the needy, we like to shower everyone with goodies. The moment you turn 65, it's like whacking the piñata. You know, you get free drugs, you get cheap movie tickets, you get bonus points at Shoppers, you get cut-rate transit, you know. And I don't know about you, but some of this stuff makes me feel a little guilty, because I know I am being subsidized by people who don't get cut-rate bus tickets, like those baristas at Starbucks where I buy my pumpkin spice lattes for $5.55, whatever it is. And so now, you know, when I go into Starbucks, I try to, as a little bit of atonement, I just try to slip a loonie into the tip jar, because I know they need it more than I do. And the best perk of all is old age security, OAS, free money, whether you need it or not, more than $550 a month. Today, a retired couple can earn up to $140,000 a year and still qualify for OAS. It isn't entirely taxed back until their household income reaches $236,000 a year. Sweet! And when the last government said, well, we're going to make some changes, very modest, very gradual, we're going to move the eligibility age back 2 years to 67, you know, what an uproar, led by Susan Eckhart, very effective. Susan is the most effective advocate in all of Canada. She's stunning. Well, you know, the thing that people say all the time is, well, we paid for this. We paid into the system, and now we're simply getting back what we paid in. And that's true for some of it. It's true for the Canada Pension Plan. You pay in, you get back. Canada Pension Plan is fully funded from past contributions. But OAS and Guaranteed Income Supplement for low-income seniors are paid entirely from current government revenues. Those are pay-as-you-go plans. And so is healthcare, which now is the single biggest government expense in any province, 50% or more. Those hips and knees, they cost money. Canadian governments now spend a collective $45,000 a year per senior in this country, compared to $12,000 for those younger than 45. And the money spent on seniors is increasing by billions every year. So here's where I get to quote from my favorite senior citizen, Leonard Cohen. Reality is one of the possibilities I cannot afford to ignore. And there's nothing more real than that demographic time bomb. So you've heard a lot about this, but I'm going to repeat some of it, because this is the nub of it. This is what we've got to think hard about. The demographic time bomb, it's quite simple. It has three parts. Life expectancy's up, fertility's down, the boomers are getting old. Any one of these things would be manageable, but the three of them together are explosive. Last year, we crossed a milestone in this country. Seniors started to outnumber children. More than one out of every six of us is now over 65. In another 15 years, it will be one in four. And we're going to live a long, long time, as I just told you. That means, yeah, we hope. That's the plan. So this means there will be a lot fewer workers to support a lot more retirees. How does that look economically? Well, you know, we've paid our way for some of it, but they're going to have to pay our way for a lot of it. And what that means...
1 minute.
1 minute. Yes. Oh, my God.
Where's the person?
whoa, where is this Pat person? Slower growth for everyone. And reduced living expectations for those millennials. Massive tax increases. It's a no-brainer then. Things will have to change. So there are a couple of things that we can do that are very important. We have to start doing now or else they'll be much harder to do later. Number one, rethink retirement age. What's so magical about quitting at 65 and hanging it up? We have to get into the 21st century, realize that 65 is no longer old, and start to say, no, you know, we should find ways to work longer, maybe not full-time, but part-time. Keep engaged in the world, and keep contributing to society in a really in a productive way. So retirement age, got to change that, gradually over a period of time. Second thing we have to do, okay, just give me one more minute. We have to target, which means we have to means test. And that means if you are more affluent, and many of us are, you're going to have to pay for things that you maybe didn't have to pay for before. And that way we'll have more money for the poorer seniors, and we'll also have more money for the millennials so that they will not be inclined to cast us out on the ice floes. It's a bit like tackling climate change. It's a long-term problem. We better start now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Margaret. It's now my pleasure to call on Susan Eng, who will deliver her opening address.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good evening, and thanks again to the Macdonald-Laurier Institute for having us here tonight. Must Canada stop coddling its spoiled seniors? Now, I say no, not unless we can find any. I would contend that we don't have any spoiled seniors, so essentially this debate is moot. Now, Margaret has clearly outed herself as a spoiled senior, so I would suggest that we stop coddling her. There are indeed a lot of seniors, 6 million and counting. And most are living healthier and longer lives than ever before. Indeed, today's seniors are not your grandmother's seniors. They are the boomers, just getting into seniorhood. Today, the oldest boomer is 70 years old, probably a few in this room. This is a generation that grew up with Pete Townsend and his very famous line, "I hope I die before I get old." So it must come as quite a shock to many in this room when you got your notices, your letters from Revenue Canada inviting you to apply for your old age security pension. Reportedly, Pete Townsend was inspired to write the song because the Queen Mother had his 1935 Packard hearse towed because she was so offended by the sight of it during her daily driveabouts. So he said that this fueled his hatred of the establishment, meaning the rich folks. But this has also become the anthem for those who resent getting old and, by extension, resenting those who are old. So to postulate that Canada has spoiled its seniors and continues to coddle them is to feed into this resentment. We all know somebody living high off the hog with a pension, with a good pension, probably a civil servant or maybe a teacher, with a very good pension. But we don't see the people who don't have enough to get by. We don't see them at the movies. We don't see them vacationing in Florida, where we might actually bump into them. They're at home with sweaters on and the heat turned down low. So we're going to buy the line that seniors are wealthier than ever, and we're going to let politicians tell us that poverty rates are the lowest than they've ever been, and when they drag their feet on building housing that seniors can afford or to bring down the cost of drugs, we think that no one will get hurt, and that's just not true. Poverty rates among seniors have indeed fallen dramatically, as Margaret has said, since the mid-70s. The poverty rate fell among seniors by an extraordinary 25 percentage points from 37% in 1976. This is where we disagree. They are at 11% in 2013. So in 1976, it was one in three seniors who could expect to live in poverty. On the first day of law school, they said to us, look to the left, look to the right. One of you will not graduate. That was mean, but it was true. That's the message. Today, the message is given to one in nine seniors. You won't make it. So we're doing better, but not enough. The pronounced decrease in the poverty rates was due to the implementation of the Canada Pension Plan in 1966. As the CPP matured, that is, as more people got the full benefit of their contributions, the poverty rates started to fall dramatically. In fact, they started to plummet right in 1976, when we had the 37% poverty rates. And they fell dramatically until about 1995. But that success did not last. The trend lines are going the other way now. Poverty rates actually fell to 3.9%, the one that Margaret mentioned, in 1995, but then they took a dramatic turn. They just turned right up to 11% in 2013. And the biggest jump was among elderly women. In four short years, from 2006 to 2010, 160,000 more seniors lived in poverty. Of that group, almost 60% were women. More than one in four today, more than one in four single seniors is living in poverty, more women than men. In human terms, that's 665,000 Canadian seniors living in poverty. Mostly the oldest, mostly single, mostly women. So these people are not spoiled. And they're not coddled either. Canada's social welfare system keeps them out of abject poverty, just. The poverty line for a single person in 2015 is just over $21,000. The maximum OAS and GIS benefits for single seniors with no other source of income is $17,000. So the poverty line is $21,000, we make sure they have $17,000. Those who have not lived in Canada for 40 years get a prorated amount. So not everybody gets a full amount. So the social welfare system in Canada doesn't even bring people up to the poverty line. It just gets them out of abject poverty into just poverty. So indeed, we have to remember also that those who are defined as living in poverty are not living just at the poverty line. Many live far below that poverty line. Food Banks Canada did a report in 2007 that said low-income single seniors live at an amount of $11,000. So that's just half of what people need to live in poverty. At these rates, it's no surprise that low-income seniors have barely enough for rent, food, or medication. So it's no wonder an increasing number of older Canadians are using food banks. In 2015, the Hunger Report said 7% of the households the food bank served were seniors, or nearly 60,000 pensioners, seniors. 60,000 Canadian seniors using food banks in 2015. That's a magic date, apparently, in this country. But that was a reality as well. This situation is not getting any better. This year, the food banks across Canada were seeing more and more older Canadians, those aged 45 to 64. In Toronto, nearly one in three people going to food banks were older Canadians. These include people who will soon be seniors. And ironically, they will find that their income will increase as they get off welfare and onto the OAS. Yet despite these realities, the previous government wanted to make Canadians wait two more years to get their OAS. There was a loud and immediate backlash from seniors across the country. Margaret credits me with sparking that backlash. Not so. I had to chase my members to find out where they were going, because they had already reacted viscerally to this issue. And remember that these seniors were going to be excluded from the change, but they knew how hard it was to get by. The government was forced to promise to reimburse provinces if they were to set up some kind of welfare income support for those people who couldn't hang on for those two extra years. But no such program was ever put in place. Besides, most seniors would not take welfare. They'd rather stick pins in their eyes. As it was, seniors dogged the politicians until they elicited election promises to reverse that change, and in fact, that reversal became law this year. Now, many of us here might be persuaded that the eligibility age for OAS should have been increased because people are indeed living longer and government coffers are feeling the strain. But let's back up a minute and ask ourselves why it is that we have an OAS as part of our pension system. The entire purpose of a country's pension system is to ensure that people do not age into poverty. This is the time in their lives when they really don't have a lot of ways to change their circumstances. And it was not some left-wing organization that defines that purpose of a pension system, it was the World Bank. All pensions operate by smoothing your income, by setting aside a part of your earnings while you're working to provide for a decent retirement, largely out of your own contributions plus investments. Our income taxes fund the payment of the old age security benefits, payable at a specified age. Canadians expect that promise to be kept, not unilaterally breached. Seniors see the OAS as a pension, their own money being given back to them for their retirement as promised. Now, seniors are still mad at Brian Mulroney for trying to take away indexing of OAS. He was confronted by some of you might remember this, he was confronted by a 63-year-old Quebec woman, Solange Denis, who shook her fist at him outside the Parliament building saying, "You lie to us. You made promises that you wouldn't touch the OAS. It's goodbye, Charlie Brown." So he backed off real quick. It took him 4 more years to introduce the clawback income testing. We have income testing, Margaret. Income testing of the OAS in 1989. Seniors are still mad at him for that, too. So no wonder Stephen Harper left the country to announce his proposal to attack the OAS. The fundamental purpose of the OAS as a public pension had not changed, and the government's purported inability to pay it and to keep its promises was hardly a good reason to break them. They should have found the money elsewhere, and in fact they did, by severely cutting their healthcare transfers to the provinces. Now, that wasn't exactly what we had in mind, but it did solve the immediate problem of the sustainability of the OAS payments. And for all that, the government had already had to back up the start date of the change to exclude most of the boomers who would have caused the strain on the public coffers. So this, in the end, became an issue of ideology, not necessity. What is necessary, however, is a strategy to care for Canada's aging population. Our hospitals are great at patching us up after a fall or saving our lives after a heart attack or a stroke, but they don't have much to offer us after we get home. Post-acute care or chronic care costs are largely borne out of pocket. The patchwork of community services barely meets the demand. And families that cannot pay the thousands of dollars a year for private home care do without, and the quality of life suffers. And those who don't have families suffer even and deteriorate even more rapidly. Indeed, it's the seniors whose families cannot take them home, or those who don't have any families or friends at all. They're the ones who are stuck in hospital beds. They should be at home or in a nursing home, but somehow our system can't figure out how to get them there. The official term for them, you might have heard this, alternate level of care, or ALC beds. You might have heard them talk about that. The unofficial name for these people, freely used until we protested, was bed blockers, as if it was their fault that they were there. That's not a term of endearment, and certainly not coddling. Now, this is not new. In 2004, the Health Accords singled out post-acute care as the quintessential challenge of Medicare, and even threw billions, with a B, billions of dollars at the problem. More than a decade later, there's really very little to show for it. Most of that money was sopped up in hospital costs and administration and just about everything else except home care. The current government has promised to spend $3 billion over 2 years directed to access to home care. But unless the structural and organizational issues are solved, we can't expect any material improvement in the situation in the lives of people who need that post-acute and chronic care. Now, most people would agree that seniors have paid their fair share throughout their lives, funding public education, paying for roads and hospitals. But most also think that seniors stop contributing once they retire and start drawing that pension. That's another myth. Pensioners continue to contribute to the economy long after the paychecks stop. Retirees who draw on workplace pensions, especially along with their OAS and CPP, spend the money, pay taxes, and support their families. They spend an estimated $60 billion annually on consumer goods. They pay $15 billion in taxes annually. In smaller towns, pensions represent about 18% of the revenues coming into the community, and it's mostly spent in the local economy. This is a major benefit for the smaller communities who demographically skew towards older Canadians. So after a lifetime of work and raising their children and paying their taxes, more and more seniors today are finding that they have to start all over again. Some have to return to work to make ends meet or to get health coverage. The number of seniors in the labor force actually doubled in the 7 years between 2006 and 2013, when over 300,000 seniors either stayed in the workforce or rejoined it. Others are taking out loans. Still others are going bankrupt. The largest increase in household debt was among seniors. When asked why they were taking on debt, only a few said that it was for a trip around the world. Some were renovating their houses so that they could stay there longer, and many were borrowing to help their kids or grandkids. So it would be fair to ask a parent or grandparent with a 30-year-old in the basement, who's spoiled and who's coddling whom? So you show me a spoiled senior that we're still coddling, and I will show you a unicorn. If we allow resentment to build up against this mythical beast, we risk undermining the few public programs we have which are aimed at preventing poverty and other indignities in old age. Seniors push back against the OAS changes, even though they themselves would not have been affected, because they wanted to look after those people who came behind them, who they knew couldn't hang on for two more years. This altruism actually underlies all of our public programs. One of the most pernicious theories that is bouncing around in the public discourse is this idea of intergenerational equity, a completely made-up term. The argument is that our children and grandchildren can't or shouldn't be paying for our retirement. But we've always done that. Every generation has paid for things that another generation uses more at any given time. Our taxes pay for the schools and universities that our kids use, just as our parents paid for our education. Our taxes pay for the hospitals where our kids were born, and they're paying for the ones we use now. The one thing that makes it such a challenge today is the accident of the baby boom, resulting in more people in the older age groups than there are in the younger cohorts. But this is not permanent. The boomer bulge, the pig in the python, if you will pass through and balance will be restored. Yet you will have heard that we have a crisis because fewer working Canadians are supporting more retirees. But that's only true if you argue that retirees do not contribute to the economy. They do. And if you ignore the lifetime of contributions they have made to bring the economy to where it is now. Canada pays 2.4% of its GDP, gross domestic product, on OAS and GIS. 2.4%. Far less than the current 8% average among OECD countries. All of them have older populations and fewer workers for every retirees, and they spend much more on public pensions. Even with the boomer bulge, our public spending increases to just 2.7% in 2030, and then drops back down to 2.6% by 2040. Crisis averted. Public policy concerns itself not with the luxuries, but with the basics. Preventing poverty and undue suffering in old age, not just to improve the averages, but to keep that promise to everyone. It's not good enough if the average senior is doing well, or even if there are a lot more wealthy seniors now. What difference does it make to the senior standing in line at the food bank to know that other seniors are doing better than ever? The key is to watch out for what happens to those below average, especially those already below the poverty line. Every time we cut our pensions or healthcare budgets, or fail to build affordable social housing, we force those below the line further down, even if everyone else just feels the pinch. We can't congratulate ourselves for a job well done if there are still 665 seniors still living in poverty, no matter what the percentages are. We need to see the people behind the numbers. We can't make the problem go away by saying it's too hard or too expensive. We can't go back to the days of the poor laws when people in need were sent to poor houses to do meaningless work to feed themselves or to make people prove that they are deserving of our charity. And we can't get around the human costs of our mean-spiritedness just by defining seniors as spoiled when they are manifestly not. That's just not who we are. Thank you.
I thank both our debaters for their opening remarks. We now will turn to Margaret again for her 5-minute rebuttal.
Well, let me start by saying one thing to the seniors in the audience. You did one thing wrong. One thing you did wrong. You didn't have enough children. Sorry. And that's one reason that we are up against a wall. Susan would like to deny that, but it's unfortunately true. Now, what she has said in her description of the plight of impoverished seniors is absolutely true. None of us would want to live on the minimum income of the poorest seniors. And she has quite properly identified problems that we must address. But like all great advocates, she has inflated the problem. And for one thing, she's used statistics that are kind of selective. They come from the Broadbent Institute, which leans a little bit to the left. I prefer statistics that are from more nonpartisan groups like the Conference Board of Canada, which cites the seniors' poverty rate at 6.7%. That's still a lot of people. That is still a serious social problem. But there are far more affluent seniors than there are poor seniors. And that speaks to a very important point. We have to differentiate. We have to distinguish. We can't pretend that everybody is the same. One problem with such powerful advocacy is that it gets in the way of changing anything at all. Politicians tremble before the seniors' lobby. Seniors vote. Young people don't. Unborn people who are going to have to pay some of these bills don't vote either, unfortunately. And the seniors' lobby fights to hold on to everything it's got and then some. Any politicians that cross them know they will be pursued by mobs of activists with lots of time on their hands. Pandering to seniors is always the path of least resistance. That's why Justin Trudeau's government rolled back the OAS changes. Now, yeah, there were some problems with the two-year interval, but we were going to have 10 years to fix those problems before anything happened to anybody. OAS is exactly the kind of entitlement that needs to be abolished for people who do not need it, and that needs to be postponed, like some other entitlements, for many of the rest of us over time, because 65 is not some kind of a magic number when we all turn into decrepit, frail old people. Your other problem is, the other mistake you are making, is you are living too long. So if you would like to relieve the burden on future generations, can you please drop dead by 75? That would be very, very convenient. It will solve all of our problems. As it is, within our lifetimes, we will have something like one worker for every dependent in Canada. 1 to 1. 1 to 1. When we were young, it was 6 to 1, 7 to 1. Think, 1 to 1. Every worker has to support, is responsible for supporting somebody who is not working, as well as raising their own families, trying to get ahead, and with all of the, you know, all of the burdens of being 30 years old, try to buy a house. Is this fair? Is it really fair to inflict the entire burden of all of our healthcare costs and our long, 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 long lives onto people who are bearing a pretty big burden already? Or is it more fair to say, okay, maybe some of us should pay a little bit more of our way and make it a little bit easier to them before they just fall down under the weight of the burdens that we are asking them to carry? That's what I mean by fairness. So please think about that part.
Thank you, Margaret. Susan, the floor is yours. 5-minute rebuttal.
Thank you. It is true that seniors have a great deal of clout today, and they use it not for themselves, but for their children and their grandchildren. Everything that seniors have fought for of late, you've heard about them, increased pensions, reducing, bringing back that change to the OAS, getting better hospital care and so on, all of these things benefit not themselves but their children and grandchildren. They will not benefit an iota from the CPP changes that are being debated in the House of Commons even as we speak. They would not have been affected by the OAS changes. They were doing this for somebody else, and they do it because they know what it takes. You have to live the life before you figure out that this is what you could lose if you don't fight for it. When you're younger, maybe that's why they don't go to vote, because they don't see what it is, what's at stake. Seniors, just by accident of living this long, know what it is that they're fighting for. And for that reason alone, they get out and vote. Not because they have a lot of time. Sometimes it's a great deal of difficulty that they have to go through in order to get out to vote. It is true that lots of us are living longer, healthier lives, but there is a persistent 10% of us who, you know, fall to the frailties of age and so on. And those people are still voting as well. And so you see voting rates that really stay high among the older voting population. And so it's not to denigrate them. They're actually using the democratic process. They're using their franchise exactly what it, for what it was meant for, namely to make sure that when you vote for something, you benefit the entire population, not just yourself. And you use the benefit of your lived experience to inform your vote and, of course, inform the attitudes of our politicians. Now, when we look at that kind of thing, when we say, well, if we're so worried about the next generation that they don't have enough, they don't have the jobs, they can't save for retirement, and we're adding this burden of our retirement costs, what are we doing instead when we start, when we try to rip up the old age security, make it more difficult, when we oppose increases to the CPP, as many parliamentarians were doing as I listened to the debates, when we start to tear up the social safety net that we've built, they're the ones who get hurt, not us. We're already in. Our situation is already baked in. The people who lose out are the next generation of people who will need all of those supports. So when we talk about what we're trying to do here, we can't, you know, play musical chairs and say, okay, the music stopped, here's where we're at. We have to look at the thing as a continuum, that each generation looks after the next, and it's looked after by the next one as well. There are many things in this in Canada, and we know this because we take a collective approach. You can't build your own airport, for example. You can't build your own pension system. There are many things you just can't do by yourself. We know it's a collective responsibility. And seniors, by exercising their franchise, actually see that very clearly. And when they exercise their franchise for the public good, they are fulfilling the proper purpose of that that benefit of the franchise. So when we look at this whole issue here, let's remember what we're trying to do. We shouldn't start by demonizing a group of people because some in that cohort actually do very well. That's collective punishment, actually, based on your class, and that's discriminatory according to our Human Rights Act. Instead, we have to look at the people, what they need, and to make sure that each according to their need, and to be able to make sure that we leave absolutely no one behind. That not even, that we should never even allow even one senior to be eating cat food in this country. Thank you.
Thank both our debaters. Now it's time, if you would like to ask questions, to do so. What we will do is have three questions in a row, and then 1 minute each. So you're going to be restricted in the time that you have to ask a question. There are microphones up here at the front. Once three questions have been asked, the debaters will be given 3 minutes each to respond to the questions. And then we will do another three, and so it will go. And there are two microphones, so feel free to come forward if you have a question. There will be this 1 minute limit, and other than that, we look forward to questions for our debaters. Sir, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I have three subjects that I wonder if you could respond why people don't talk about them. And the one is why people don't talk about the fact that in 1968, the federal government added a percentage increase to our federal income tax to pay for OAS. That is a fact, and we always hear that OAS comes out of the public coffers. Well, yes, it does, but there's individual tax money that went into the coffers to pay for that. The other thing that nobody talks about is related to jobs. Now, I don't want to get into the question of why we lost so many jobs in Canada, but we've lost a lot of jobs. And if all the unemployed youth that are supporting seniors were working, would we still be having the same conversation about young people supporting seniors? Nobody talks about that perspective. And the other perspective, I don't remember.
Well,
I'll leave it for somebody else to ask. Thank you.
Second question then, sir.
Okay. So my question is for Ms. Eng. And you've said that intergenerational equity is a fabricated concept or doesn't exist, which I take issue with to a great extent. And I would like to know that 40 years from now, since we don't have the means for, and, you know, my demographic to support the elderly people now, when I'm actually, well, my generation, millennials, are actually impoverished and eating cat food, what do you think the Susan Eng representing my group 40 years from now would have said to the Susan Eng now that what could have been done differently to avoid that situation? Thank you.
And our third question here.
It's clear from what one knows is that healthcare is a very major issue. And in some ways, I think it's like the elephant in the room. Other countries, and I'm talking Europe, I'm not talking the US, have a mixed private and public system. To what extent do you think we should be examining this in an open and fair way, looking at France and Germany and the Scandinavian countries as ways to help that 50% of our provincial taxes going to healthcare?
Margaret, the floor is yours. Respond. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks very much. I think I'll deal with the go in reverse order and deal with the last one first, because you've raised an extremely salient issue. We cannot talk about seniors and seniors care without talking about healthcare, obviously, because seniors are the biggest users of the system, and will continue to be so. We will be the biggest strain on the system in the coming years, just because we're getting old. It is absolutely crucial that we combine. This discussion of seniors care with healthcare, because they're so intertwined, you cannot separate them. You're absolutely correct. We're the only country in the world that where nobody pays for anything, basically. Every other country in the world, I think, except for Cuba and North Korea, have a mixed system. I won't refer to the United States because I think they have a way worse system than we do. But we absolutely should be looking to France, the Scandinavian countries, which have a combined public-private system, which takes some burden off of the public system and also allows and often requires people who are more affluent to pay. Why? I believe there is really no reason why affluent people, including affluent seniors, should be getting everything for free, free MRIs and free everything else. Because it robs us of our ability to be progressive and to target our resources to people who need them more. You know, this is a sacred cow in Canada, but we should slay it. As for the earlier gentleman who pointed out that OAS was added in as a federal tax increase, I didn't know that, but actually that reminds me of lots of other things that were, they put a special tax increase in just for some specific purpose, and then it kind of disappeared into general revenues. That's pretty common.
1 minute left.
As for jobs for young people, actually the employment rate is pretty good in this country. Our unemployment rate is quite low at the moment, except in Alberta and a couple of other spots. It is true that employment for the next generation is going to be, as our finance minister said the other day, more precarious, with fewer benefits. More people can expect to do more jobs in a lifetime, have to be far more flexible, will not have the job security that we did. This is not specific to Canada. The entire Western world is facing this challenge. It is a very big one, and it's a very important one, but it's also another reason why I think we need to be cognizant of the fact that the millennials are not going to have it as good as we did. And so there is an equity issue built into that as well for the rest of us. Thanks.
Thank you. Susan, the floor is yours.
First, on the healthcare issue, yes, in Europe they do have a mixed public and private system, but what that actually means is that they have public hospitals and doctors and other doctors who receive payment through the insurance system. That's what makes it so-called private. Because they have mandatory insurance mechanisms, it's more affordable, so people can afford to actually have private health insurance, which they use either for those doctors that take private insurance or instead go to hospitals. So they can afford to do that. If we're going to copy them, we have to copy everything that they're doing, not just bits and pieces. As for the issue of intergenerational equity, nobody raised that phrase when there were more boomers than their parents. So the idea is that somehow because this group is larger than the younger group, that is unfair. It isn't, that isn't the point. The point is that the economy today has precarious employment. That's unfair. The economy today, most workplaces have no workplace pension. Many boomers today had workplace pensions. Now two-thirds of working Canadians do not have it, except civil servants and other government workers who are paid out of public funds. So when our seniors today are fighting to hang on to defined benefit pension plans, they're doing it for you, so that there are more workplaces that actually still provide that kind of income support. Their actual wages during the period of time that boomers were in the workforce were not as high as they are now, but they had the backup of the pension system. So it's a larger picture than that. And when we're talking about intergenerational warfare, let's not talk about that. It shouldn't be either or, but it should be both and. You have to be part of the solution that we're talking about that makes sure that there is decent employment for everybody. It's not as if we don't have millennials in our families. You know, we're not sort of discrete groups. Everybody has a family member who's either a senior or a millennial. So we care about everybody. But the point is that we can't, you know, denigrate seniors and say, well, you know, the millennials are therefore the good guys, right? We shouldn't burden them. Whereas that's just the wrong formula. The focus has to be how we can do things together. What are the challenges that we have to meet together? And one of them is a precarious economy. Some of the choices that are being made are unacceptable, and we have to join in the protest against these kinds of changes. As for the, and I think Herb mentioned that, you know, that the need for better employment is one of the solutions that we work for. I have a sign that says stop, so I shall. Thank you.
Okay. Further questions?
Would anyone like the microphone brought to them? Who has a question?
Just wave.
Okay, sir, okay. Go ahead.
Speaking about equity, today's seniors have some pretty good balance sheets. In fact, I understand that over the next 20 to 30 years, there will be the most enormous transfer of wealth that we've ever known that goes to these poor people who are behind us. And I'm just curious what the debaters might say about that.
Next question, sir. Floor is yours.
A few minutes ago, somebody mentioned an elephant in the room. Well, there's a T-Rex in the room, which neither of the speakers have addressed, but I thought Margaret was about to, and then she shied. But with the current immigration numbers, a lot of people will want to bring their aged parents in, and they won't care for all these elderly racists who don't have any kids anyway, and that sort of stuff. And a lot more seniors will suddenly be added to the ranks of those in pensions. And from the point of view of overburdening the system, you may not have seen nothing yet. And that's a rather large issue which has to be confronted in any discussion like this, one way or the other.
Okay, and the third question, sir, for you.
Susan, you already defended against pension reform, and Margaret's proposals have seemed pretty reasonable to me. I don't think it's absurd to ask people to work for half your life or less. But Margaret's other proposal, tiering OAS to income. The top 10% in Canada starts at around 130,000. And someone can keep earning OAS till 118K. So how on earth does it seem reasonable for someone like myself, who's earning 50,000, to pay into taxes to top up the salary of someone earning $100,000.
Okay, thank you for the questions. Margaret, the floor is yours, 3 minutes, okay.
Yes, I'll take them in reverse order again. How is it reasonable for someone earning $50,000 to top up somebody earning $100,000? It beats me. honest to God, it beats me. But that this points up, again, one of the great barriers to change, because whenever you suggest making even reasonable changes, advocacy groups swing into action, and they start talking about people eating cat food. So that's why it is so hard to make even sensible changes. This is just human nature, because once you have a program in place, it is incredibly, incredibly, incredibly difficult for any state to give it up or modify it or moderate it or take something away from somebody who already has it. It's just human nature. As for the immigration question, there's been a lot of discussion, you've heard it, about powerful advisors to the government want to increase immigration rates dramatically in order to help pay the bills of the elderly. Whether that is feasible is another great debate that I'm sure you will have soon. The costs and the benefits of immigration. In any event, immigration will not make very much difference to our overall balance sheet issues in the long run. The issue of elderly immigrants depends entirely on immigration policy and the extent to which the government advocates family reunification. Because if they do, then you are going to get elderly immigrants in, and immigrants get old too. As for pretty good balance sheets, boomer balance sheets, yes, boomers are already the wealthiest people in Canada. Seniors already have most of the wealth in Canada. Again, I'm not going to generalize about every senior, but as a group, yeah, we have most of the wealth in Canada. We're going to get more. Again, that's an argument for a system that is more targeted. Dare I mention means testing? That's a really, really un-Canadian thing to do. But yeah, we need to be doing more of that in all of our benefits and also our health care. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Susan, the floor is yours, 3 minutes. Okay.
Yes, thank you. The enormous transfer of wealth is something that we get dollar signs in our eyes, and that's terrific. And for those families who do transfer a lot of wealth to their children or grandchildren, more power to them. There just remains way too many people who do not have anybody transferring wealth to them. And we do have to look at that. You know, our public policy is not that much interested on the very wealthy, except maybe to tax them. But we do have to concern ourselves with making sure that every Canadian lives in dignity, no matter what their age is. And so that's something that we have to work towards. The idea that we should have means testing, I think we've talked about that a little bit, and the idea that 130,000 is too high a number to have and still get old age security. Remember what I said at the beginning, is that old age security was something that somebody owned, just like you wouldn't take somebody's Bell Canada pension away from them because they have too much money. So too do a lot of people think you should not take their OAS pension away from them because they have too much money. And as I mentioned, Brian Mulroney brought in income testing to claw back that income at $130,000. And many of you think that that threshold should be lower. That's a debate we can have. But that's where that lies. And I don't think there's any kind of unfairness unless you look at what the original purpose was. You have to look at why it was that people feel that whatever they set aside, whatever that money earned for them, is their entitlement to get back when they need it. And if they happen to have done well in life up until that point, why is it that they can't have the money they've set aside? So that's the opposite argument. When you talk about the retirement age, remember you have to separate two things. When you have to stop working or can continue working is one thing. When you get access to pensions and other income supports or pensions are two separate things. And so when the government chose to increase the age of entitlement to old age security, they're not saying that, oh, well, you know, that means you're going to have to work for two more years. It just meant you weren't going to get this pension payment for two more years later. But that's fine for people who can work for two more years. In fact, many, many people around age 65 really love their work, and their employers will keep hiring them, and so they keep working. It's terrific. But that's not everybody. The people we worry about are people whose bodies wear out at age 50 or 55 or maybe 60 if they hang on a bit longer. And then there's that five-year gap. It's going to be a seven-year gap where they have no options. So those are the kinds of things that we have to worry about when we talk about this issue.
Thank you. Questions?
Sir. Yes, I'd just like to say that I think that it's not that seniors have too much, it's that the other generations have too little. And I think that we've got to stop trying to take things away from seniors, but giving more to other generations. And we can learn from what seniors have. First of all, if we take the question of income, yeah, the OAS is a good thing, but we should have a guaranteed annual income so that millennials also have something. That is something which is being discussed very widely and voted on in many European countries. So maybe we're only at the beginning of that discussion. Secondly, we take the question of drugs. I mean, it's great that seniors have, I'm one of them, Medicare can get drugs for free, but everybody should be able to get their drugs for free. Everybody, it shouldn't be something which PharmaCare should be part of our Medicare system. So she'd be extending that, not taking that away from seniors. And lastly, the question of jobs. Many continue to work and many have jobs. And the point is, it's not that we should take those away from them. We should be creating more jobs for young people. And we should be seeing it's much more difficult for young people to get into the workforce. We should have plans which do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions, sir?
Yes. Well, as I gaze upon this group of rich, intelligent, and well-meaning people, I'm sure we're going to come to the right conclusion that this is a framing exercise. We're all pretty fine ourselves, and the real question is, are we more worried about ourselves than about our younger generation coming up? And I, for one, am far more concerned about what the future portends for them than what it does for me, and I think most people will feel that way. And so I think we're one society, and as Burke said, we're all a kind of contract between generations. The real question is, how much are we getting out of it as older, rich, intelligent, and successful people such as we are in this room, vis-a-vis what our kids are getting? And I think that's the framing, that's the real issue. Thank you.
And the third question here, sir.
Thank you. This question is maybe more for Margaret. Do you think that Canada's seniors have paid or will pay their fair share of carbon taxes?
Okay. Well, we'll now have answers to the questions. Margaret, we'll start with you.
Yeah, you know, that last question is very, very interesting because... And I'll deal with it a bit more in my final remarks because it's a long-term issue where we need to take action now in order to get results we need tomorrow. And I think on the subject of the environment, a lot of the younger generation would look at my generation and say, you guys are really asleep. And we fault you for that. On the issue of, framing. I thought that was just a marvelous comment. I don't know if there was a question embedded there, but it was just a great comment, yeah. The first issue, GAI for everyone, free drugs for everyone, jobs for young people, yeah, all those things would be great. And if we could figure out how to do it, wouldn't it be great? Those are, you know, pretty big challenges, and if somebody could figure it out, I would vote for that person tomorrow. But those are very, very big challenges within our current constrained circumstances, and they're easier to say we want than to get. Thank you.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Susan. The floor is yours.
I think that the where we're getting to here is we don't want to take money away from one generation to give to the next. What we have to remind ourselves here is why are we dividing ourselves up into generations? Even David Foote, the great demographer, boom, bust, and echo, was one to say that, yes, this is a set of facts. Our population will be, you know, largely X age, and then it becomes Y age, and then it becomes Z age. And during that period of time, as you see the bulge go through society, society has to get ready. You have to build more schools when you anticipate the bulge to be coming, and you repurpose those schools when it passes through. And he was quick to say that, look, you know, we knew that these were the demographic challenges for our society, but somehow the politicians never believed it. And so they didn't build the schools when they needed them, and then they suddenly built the schools when they were already overcrowded, with the net necessity that they are now empty, and they have to find things to do with these schools. Same thing with nursing homes. They knew very well that this group was going to continue to age, but they never built the nursing home. So now we have a crisis. No nursing homes to go into, no money for home care, stuck in hospitals called bed blockers. So the challenge for us as public policy pundits, I guess, is to say, let's look at this as if it really mattered, as if we know what we're talking about and make things happen for people. We're not finding ourselves there. And so a lot of these you know, frictions are happening because we choose not to look at the whole picture, but we consistently try to divide up our population as if we were never young once and that we're never all going to age. That's the thing that's a little bit different about demography as opposed to, say, something like manufacturing. You can't isolate these different issues.
Thank you. Okay. Have we used the 25 minutes? Okay. That concludes the question period then. All right. So we'll go back to the final concluding statements from our debaters. And I call Ken and Margaret to lead off a five-minute speech for each of our debaters to conclude.
I don't see this as a battle of the generations. That's not a good characterization. I don't think it is. It's a search for fairness and for balance. It's a search for what is progressive and not regressive. And it's a test of our values as a society, I think. And I think that the case for reform is on the progressive side of the ledger. The case for doing nothing, making no changes in what we're doing now, is on the regressive side of the ledger. You know, my husband and I have a little house up north of Toronto, and it's a beautiful area, hills and woods. But it wasn't always so beautiful. Around the turn of the last century, loggers came by, and they cut down all the trees. They deforested the whole area. And the soil eroded, and the land turned into sand dunes. The loggers didn't really know what they were doing, but that was the effect, because they weren't thinking about the long term. And it took two or three generations to bring that land back. Generations of planting pine forests, and then allowing the hardwood trees to take root. We know better now. We manage the forests, taking what we need without destroying the ecosystem. We don't want to be the generation that cut down all the trees. We boomers have benefited from the strongest economy in history. We account for a minority of the population, but a majority of the wealth. We've enjoyed far better income growth than our children will. And yet, despite our good fortune of many, not all of us, but quite a few, some people want to pull ever more out of the economy as they age. And if they get their way, the people stuck with the bills, next generation, will have to do with less. Personally, I don't believe that most of us think this way. I don't believe we are greedy and spoiled. I believe that most of us, including the people in this room, want what's fair and just. We have already proved this in the way we build our social safety net. We have one of the fairest societies in the world. We've built a much fairer and more equal society than the Americans. We've come pretty close to eradicating child poverty. We have a better, fairer education system and a much fairer healthcare system than they do. We also have a history of prudent fiscal management, unlike the Americans. Unlike the Americans and most of the European countries, we have mostly paid our way. Canada pension plan system is the envy of the world. It's fully funded. And now, our challenge is to create a fair and prosperous society, not for this generation, which we have mostly done, not totally, but mostly, but for the generations that come after. What do we want our legacy to be? That we were selfish people who let short-term self-interest and petty politics rule the day and saddled our grandchildren and their grandchildren with higher taxes and grimmer prospects, less money for schools, and the environment, and their own old age? Or that we were prudent and far-sighted and took a little less for ourselves today so that folks could have enough tomorrow? Do we want to be the people who cut down all the trees or the people who learn to manage the forests? Ladies and gentlemen, I think you know the answer. Thank you.
Susan, 5 minutes.
Thank
for you
very much. Before I started this debate, my very good friend said to me, I hope you don't agree on everything. This is supposed to be a debate. And indeed, the one thing that I will agree with Margaret is that I think that she does, as I do, think that we have a wonderful country. We have a great deal of fairness, and we got this way because we have altruistic programs. Those who needed it got support, and those who didn't need so much did not take as much out of the system. And I suppose she argues that that balance is now inappropriate and that we have to rebalance it. And maybe that's so, but let's keep our eye on what's happening here. There's nobody here afraid of change or who doesn't want reform, so long as that reform is for the better. We resisted the change to OAS because some people were going to get hurt and no one was looking after them. There was no program in place to look after those people. When we look at the Canada Pension Plan, it is indeed doing extremely well. And the only way it can continue to do extremely well is that it's mandatory, that everybody working in Canada contributes to it, so we can afford to have it. The amount of money that we pay into it by the end of our careers is minuscule compared with what we get back out. We couldn't do that on our own. Those who want to abandon the CPP and set employers against employees, you've heard that dialogue. Those people want to destroy the social safety net that we so value, that makes it possible for us to have a good, healthy retirement, and that we want for our kids and grandkids as well. And the only way we can have it for them is we don't tear it up now. And so those are the kinds of things that we have to look at together. The kinds of hopes and opportunities, for example, pharmacare, these things are doable. Full employment, possibly doable. So for example, if we're talking about young people and their jobs, why is it that all of our jobs are fleeing the country? Why do we have low-wage jobs and we don't get back the high-wage jobs? Well, here's what Germany did. It had an apprenticeship system that carried on from public school into community colleges, into on-the-job training. And they forced the companies to each pay into that system so that when people were in schools, they had a path to employment. And there was no company that could take somebody else's trainees and scoop all the money that they had spent on those trainees and use them in their business, because there was a mandatory fee that they had to pay as part of that industry. So these are things that we can do as a country. And I can tell you that any seniors advocate, of which I count myself, I would say that we would support that. Not for ourselves, but for our children and grandchildren. We're not leaving behind the millennials. It's just that we know what we need to do together to get these things done. Pharmacare is doable too. Right now we have this patchwork across that country. It is true. Many seniors have many drugs that are covered, but often not the ones they actually need. And different provinces have different ideas. And the politicians are sort of tiptoeing around and say, oh, why don't we get a few generic drug prices down? And that's as much as they have done. And they won't look at the larger picture, which is to actually get a single formulary or a single price and get rid of the 13 administrations that actually spend so much of our money deciding whether or not to pay for these drugs. That's how we can actually achieve the thing that we all want across all the generations. So there's an opportunity here as we raise the issue and debate among ourselves that there are solutions, not the ones that have been proposed, nitpicking, means testing, which often becomes mean testing. You know, we talk about, you know, some kind of income threshold before you get your drugs covered. Well, that's fine. But in Alberta, they had that level down so low that people living near the poverty line were going to have to come up with major copay. So we can't have that kind of means testing. So we have to look at what we're talking about before we adopt the kind of, just the name of the programs that are elsewhere. There's an opportunity here for the generations to work with each other. And especially from the seniors' perspective, they have lived a life, take advantage of their experience. They know how hard it is to make ends meet. And you can tap into their voting clout by joining them. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I'd like to congratulate and thank our two debaters for the wonderful presentations they've made tonight, the answers to the questions and their rebuttal and so on. I hope that you've enjoyed the debate very much, and I thank them on your behalf for all they've done. But I'd like to put the final question to you to see if there's been any shift in opinion. And the resolution, Canada must stop coddling its spoiled seniors. How many agree? How many disagree? Still a majority there. And how many are unsure or undecided? Oh, that group has shrunk a bit. A good sign that the debate's been successful, at least in that regard. So I congratulate our debaters. I thank you all for being here tonight and your participation. I hope you've enjoyed the discussion. And we look forward to the next debate. Brian, I'm sure, will tell us about that. And we hope we'll see you again before long.
Thank you.
Good debating never gets old. Mesdames et messieurs, voilà qui met fin à la partie formelle de notre débat ce soir. Peter has already thanked the debaters, which I obviously join him in doing, but nobody ever thanks Peter except me, and now I'm going to ask you to do the same. I would like to mention once again those who helped make this evening possible. Of course, thank you to the Canadian War Museum and their CEO, Mark O'Neill, for this wonderful venue and for their support. We always love working with the staff here at the War Museum. And thanks to the MLI staff, David Watson, Mark Brownlee, Joanna Roach, our intern Shamil, and our student volunteers for all they did. Thanks to the Hecht Foundation, who has sponsored today's Great Canadian Debate. We really appreciate their support, and should any of you want to join them in sponsoring these debates, please contact us at the Institute. And lastly, thanks to all of you for taking the time to be here tonight. We're still working out the details of the rest of the season. I'm pretty sure we're going to have a debate on whether or not Medicare violates the rights of Canadians, which is an issue before the courts right now, as you know. And we've got several other timely topics, perhaps one about whether governments should be subsidizing newspapers, which is another timely topic. Perhaps we should hurry that one up and have the debate before the newspapers all fold. Sorry. And may I remind you again that this evening's debate was organized by the Macdonald-Laurier Institute. I'm Brian Lee Crowley, the managing director. Some of our publications are available outside. Merci d'être venu et à la prochaine.